Perfect? Bang on my chest if you think I'm perfect.
Go ahead, bang on it.
No heart?
You gotta have heart. Miles and miles of heart.
This is Patchwork Heart Ministries' Young Catholics Respond, brought to you by Breadbox Media. Now, here's your host, Bill Snyder.
Thanks, Adam. Indeed, I am Bill Snyder, and welcome to the program, everyone. It is a pleasure to be with you today, no matter how you're listening, whether it's on Breadbox Media, on Evangelism Radio, or right here on Patchwork Heart Radio. It is a blessing that you have joined us. Today, my guest is Patch Drury. He is an award-winning writer, professional filmmaker, published cartoonist, public speaker, former pastor, and depending on who you ask, he might be a heretic. Patch spent nearly 40 years in the Christian church, 10 of those as a pastor, before he felt something, God, calling him to a bigger playground. Now he uses the works of visionaries like Joseph Campbell and Carl Jung as roadmaps, and he explores ideas like God, religion, transcendence, and bliss, and he hopes that everybody follows their bliss. His podcast is on Breadbox Media, and it is entitled Patch Drury is Blissed. Patch, welcome to the program, and thank you so much for joining me here on Patchwork Heart Radio.
Thank you so much for having me. It's great to be here.
So I want to find out a little bit about your personal spiritual journey, just to start out with here on today's program.
Okay. Well, I live in Lexington, Kentucky, and I was born about 30 minutes from here and grew up in just the best of all possible worlds. My parents were kind and loving, and they were also Christians. Now I'm given to understand that most of your audience is probably Catholic. I grew up Protestant, and Protestant Christians, we would have called it non-denominational, but that in itself becomes a denomination the minute you say non-denominational.
Right.
But so grew up there, had a really loving family. My parents were the best kinds of Christians. And I say that knowing that you know all kinds of great Christians, but sometimes when I interact with people outside of faith circles, you say, my parents were Christians, and they're like, oh, did they beat you? I want to make sure I draw a picture of them as the kindest, most loving people possible. And so I grew up in church, was in church three times a week, went to Christian college, studied ministry, went into my first job as a children's minister at a church in Florida. And that lasted about 2 years. And I'll be honest, they fired me, and they fired me because I was in my 20s and I didn't know how to work. I just had no idea. My parents had taken great care of me. My dad had a great work ethic. But sometimes when you've spent your life working, sometimes you try to shield your kids a little bit from some of the grueling parts of that. And so I just didn't know how to work. And so they rightly fired me. And so I came back to Kentucky, went to work for my dad. He owns a body shop. I worked at that body shop for 11 years. And in that process, I had also found a church that I was that was my church home. And during those 11 years, I thought, you know, I think I could get back into it. I think I could go back into ministry. And so I started talking to this church about me working there. And this was a larger church, and they needed somebody to do video work. And so I taught myself how to do video, and I became really immersed in video. And so they hired me. And so I worked there for almost 8 years. Well, it was 8 years. And it was great. It was my home. That's where a lot of my connections were. It just became kind of the center of my life. It's where I met my wife, more or less. And so was working there at that church, and then my wife got pregnant with our first child. And so I started having those thoughts that you have. Are you a dad? Are you a father?
No, I'm not.
Okay, well, here, I'll just warn you. When you know you're going to have a kid, you start having these thoughts about, what am I going to teach this kid about the world? What am I going to tell him about love and about relationships and about work? And one of the big ones was, what am I going to tell him about God? And so I thought about this a lot. And I started realizing some of the things that I was going to have to tell him about God, some of the things that I had come to believe, I didn't like that much. That I kind of had a picture of God that ultimately didn't make a lot of sense to me, that when you looked at the way the world was and then you looked at the way God was, they didn't quite line up exactly. Uh-huh. And so this started causing me a lot of stress. And so this stress manifested itself by I started itching all over. And my wife finally said, "Why are you itching all the time?" And we figured out it was because I was stressed about these questions I was having in my mind. So she said, "Well, you have to go to a therapist." And so she went with me. We went to a therapist and kind of told him what was up. And we discovered that I kind of hadn't been through what some people would call an individuation process. So I had all of my life had kind of believed in and followed all the authority figures in my life, be it my parents, my pastor, the church, government, teachers, whatever it was. If an authority figure said it, I believed it. That was the end of it. And the individuation process is where you kind of become the authority in your own life to a certain degree, where when you get handed a thing, you look at it and you say, "Do I believe this or not?" And if you don't believe it, you put it in the throwaway pile. If you believe it, you put it in the keep pile. And I think regardless of how you feel about authority figures, anybody could look at it and say, "Oh, yeah, that's super important." Because if you believe something, you have to really believe it. It has to be meaningful to you and it has to mean something. You can't just believe it because somebody told you it was true. And so I had never been through that process. So in going through that process, I kind of said, "Well, what if I don't believe a lot of the religion that I was given? What do I do with that?" And so around the same time at this church I was working at, they started asking me to do a different job, something different than I had started there doing. And I was terrible at it. And I kept saying to them, "Don't make me do this job. I'm terrible at it. Don't make me do it." But they wanted me to do it. And so there was this, and I was really honest with the leadership about, "Man, I'm really going through some doubts right now." And so eventually it came to the point where between me not being very good at what they were asking me to do and having a lot of doubts about the faith I was supposed to be advocating on a weekly basis, I kind of became a liability as a employee. And so we parted ways again as a second church. They asked me to resign, but we're all adults. We know that's getting fired. And so I say sometimes my hobby is getting fired from churches because it seems to happen so much. But at any rate, so I came to a point where I didn't have this job anymore. I didn't have a lot of the family connections that were at this church. And so my wife was great. She just kind of said, "Well, what do you want to do next?" And I said, "Well, I think I'm just going to go get a job editing video somewhere." And she said, "No, you don't want to have a boss. Your relationship with authority has changed. You're not going to do well being told what to do." And so she really encouraged me to go out into business for myself. I feel like I'm talking so long. I apologize.
Oh, no. This is a great story.
Good. I'm glad to hear. So she encouraged me to go into business for myself. So I started a small video production company on my own. And I did that for about 3 years. And I realized, even though I didn't have a boss that I was particularly reporting to, because I was having all these clients, I was basically getting a new boss with every new job. And also I kind of realized I didn't enjoy making other people's visions come to life as much as I thought I would. Because I was good at video, because I had done well with it, I assumed that's what my thing was. But I realized after doing it for 3 years, I'm good at it, I can do it, but it's not my thing. It's not my bliss, as I would say, in the world I travel in these days. So I started asking myself, what is my bliss? And a little side note here, in doing video at this church, I wanted to get really good at telling stories because so much of video is storytelling. So I researched this guy who was one of my favorite storytellers. His name is Dan Harmon. Dan Harmon created the show, TV show Community, and the cartoon Rick and Morty. And so in researching him, I found out that he created something called a story circle that told how to tell a story for television or for movies. And that story circle was based on the works of Joseph Campbell. And so I kind of backwards engineered from Dan Harmon to Joseph Campbell. And I realized Joseph Campbell, what he did, he was a comparative religion professor. If people don't recognize the name, he was a comparative religion professor. He studied all the religions of the world. And he kind of figured out that all the religious stories, all the mythologies of all these different religions were kind of telling the same story. And you kind of saw the same things happening over and over in these stories. And so he mapped out this this pattern, and he called it the monomyth. And he and so it's not 100%. You won't always see it, but you can look at it and look at these little points in the monomyth and realize they pop up in a lot of religious stories. And so he said, this is significant. This tells you something about the human journey and about us as humans. And so I was really familiar with this monomyth, and I was really a geek about Joseph Campbell. I tried to read everything of his I could. And so the neat thing about the monomyth is you can kind of lay it over your own life and see the pattern emerging. And so I was able to lay it over my journey with the church and my wife telling me to work for myself and me going into video and all this stuff and not loving it, and see that it lined up with the monomyth. And I was fascinated by that. I couldn't believe that there was this pre-existing universal framework pattern that could be applied in so many places. And so I kind of became obsessed with it. And it got to the point where I would sit and watch TV with my wife, and I would point out to her stuff happening on the TV show that was the monomyth. I'd be like, okay, well, here's what's going to happen next. This happened. Now this happened. Here's why this character is doing this, and used it to kind of explain TV to her. And so eventually she was like, you have to stop. You're driving me crazy with this. I can't enjoy TV with you. you've got to figure out some other expression of this, some other way to use the monomyth. And so I started a podcast called Blissed, where every week I sit down with people who I believe are following their bliss. And so where does that come in? I believe the monomyth, all these religious stories, are telling us how to go inside of ourselves and find the thing that gives us life. And ultimately, in my opinion, the thing that gives you life is when you are the truest version of yourself, when you are following your highest enthusiasm. And so that's the connection to bliss. And so I talk to different people here locally and around the country about, what are you doing? How are you following your bliss? And so then I'll take steps from the monomyth and ask them questions about that. Like, the very first step is the call to adventure. So you feel called, you feel a calling on your life. And so I'll ask them, what was that moment for you? When did you feel called to pursue this path you're on? And from there, just kind of get them to dissect their own bliss in efforts and hopes of helping other people find their bliss.
No. How beautiful is that? And, you know, just for our listeners, you're listening to Patch Drury. He, the voice of Patch Drury. He is also on Breadbox Media with his podcast Blissed. And Patch, this is just a fascinating conversation. I hate to, you know, even cut you off, because you've got because you just got such an amazing story. I mean, what a fascinating thing, and how incredible! I'm listening to this, so fascinated by what you're talking about, and I'm hoping that our listeners are the same way, because I have a whole nother 13 minutes to talk to you about this.
Please tell me I didn't just talk for 13 minutes.
No. Pretty close. Okay. But pretty close. But no, we'll talk on the other side of this break all about, you know, more about how and what you're doing to help people as a coach, and more about this monomyth, because I got to hear about it. So right back after these messages here on Young Catholics Respond on Breadbox Media, Evangelism Radio, and Patchwork Heart Radio.
The Contemplative Stations of the Cross audio devotional is now available from Patchwork Heart Ministry. This devotional features an introduction and overview of the theology, history, and spirituality of the Stations of the Cross by Father Bill Zimmer, a priest of the Archdiocese of Chicago, along with an audio version of the Contemplative Stations of the Cross led by author Bill Snyder, and the Stabat Mater, chanted in Latin by Marissa Ellison. CDs are $7.99, and digital downloads are only $3.99. Copies may be purchased by visiting patchworkheart.org or calling 424-704-3278. That's 424-704-3278.
Hi, everybody. Bill Snyder here. Just want to thank you for listening to this episode of Young Catholics Respond. And as a founder of Patchwork Heart Ministry, we have so much more going on than just our podcasts. Check it out at patchworkheart.org.
Our Blessed Mother wants only the best for her children and has given us a special place where she promises to help all those who appeal to her motherly love and protection. Telling Saint Juan Diego that here I will alleviate the sufferings of all those who love me and seek my protection. That holy place is now the site of the beautiful Shrine of Our Lady of Guadalupe in Mexico City. If you would like to learn more about how you can visit this special place of grace, please visit vivaguadalupe.org for more information. Our Lady may be calling you now.
Your heart is always beating, but you never have to think about it.
Welcome back to Young Catholics Respond. Once again, Bill Snyder.
Welcome back, everyone, to this episode of Young Catholics Respond. I am Bill Snyder. Today, my guest is Patch Drury, and he is talking with us all about bliss today and finding your bliss, his spiritual journey, his personal journey in life and spiritual journey. Rewind this podcast and listen to it again, because he truly has a fascinating journey. But I want to kind of talk with you, Patrick, now about the the evangelical nature of finding your bliss, if I can do that, if that makes any sense, and also what you're doing to help people on the ground floor as a bliss coach. So maybe just start there.
Okay, well, two things come to mind when you ask that way. One, there's a Joseph Campbell quote that I paraphrase in my podcast all the time, and I am not going to get it word for word, but basically he says, the influence of a vital person vitalizes. And so that was kind of the heart of his work. And he taught at Sarah Lawrence College, and he taught his students to pursue their bliss. And the idea is, when you pursue your bliss, you become a vitalized best version of yourself. And then when you rub up against other people, they benefit from that. The effect of you coming into contact with them is you vitalize them. And so I believe in that. I believe we sharpen each other. We pull each other up to where we are. You know, there's the whole thing about you are the five people you hang around with. And so if you hang around with people that aren't the best version of themselves, you ultimately aren't probably going to be either. And so I believe in finding people and helping them discover their bliss so that they can be the best version of themselves and the effect can ripple out. That's my first thought when you say that. I talked so much last time. I want to make sure I pause a little bit so that you can jump in if you want to at any point.
Yeah, no, that's wonderful. That's wonderful. And you know, the idea that you're doing this and helping others find their bliss, whether it be through the podcast and they're listening to this as an introduction, but then you also are a bliss coach. And what exactly is that? What exactly do you do as a bliss coach? You know, I mean, it's a kind of like a life coach.
It's life coaching in a lot of ways, and I am a certified life coach, but specifically it's trying to take some of the tenets of life coaching that people may or may not be familiar with and seeing how they merge with the monomyth and the teachings of Joseph Campbell, and specifically helping people discover if they don't know what their bliss is, if they don't know why they're here, or if they're working a desk job and they just feel empty inside, helping them maybe figure out. And it's not changing careers necessarily. It's not like I'm saying, oh, well, you're working the wrong job. It may be that they need to stay at that job, but then there's something else that can become their passion that they can devote additional time to. And so it's helping people kind of figure out what is the thing that's driving them. And so I will sit down with someone and I have exercises. So the entire monomyth is like 17 steps. So it's not a 17-week process. It's like a 6 to 8 week process where I kind of distill it down to the points that I think are most important and help the person kind of just lay that framework over their life and answer questions about their life based on that. Does that make sense?
It does. It does. And probably extremely helpful for people. What are some of the backgrounds of people that you work with? I mean, is it all different types?
It's all different types. The client that I'm spending a lot of time with right now is a photographer. And so he kind of knew photography was his bliss, but he was at a place where he was really stuck creatively. And he reached out to me and said, can you help me with this? And to me, it felt like the same thing. Like, yes, you know that you want to spend your life taking pictures and you're really passionate about this, but what is it that you need to say with those pictures? What is the burning message inside of you? And so I sat down and kind of helped him go through the monomyth and kind of get to that. And it's a whole process of figuring out what are you passionate about? What's the message? What's the problem that you see in the world that needs to be fixed? What are your fears? What are you scared of? What is your identity at the bottom of everything? And so it's been like, that's one guy. Another lady contacted me after listening to the podcast and said, I know if I keep listening to this podcast, it's going to upset my apple cart. It's going to screw my life up because I'm not following my bliss now. And she meant it in a positive way, but there is this truth to the fact that when you discover your bliss, when you discover that thing that you were created for, your old life kind of gets thrown on the fire, you know, because you can't just sit and maintain when you have a mission, you know, and that sometimes is what life is. Life is maintaining. It's go to work, come home, fix dinner, sit in front of the TV, try to relax enough that I can go back to work. And your bliss does not make that easy.
Right. Right. And how many people, this just kind of was the burning question, listening to you talk there, was how many people do you think are following their bliss in the United States of America today? Like, how many people do you think are doing that?
I have no idea. I would say probably not very many, especially if you had such a limited definition of bliss as it needing to be your profession, then obviously not very many people. But I think that's too limiting a definition. I think we all have a sense. You mentioned at the top of the interview that one of the people that I rely on a lot teaching-wise is Carl Jung. And Carl Jung, what he did when he was trying to discover his bliss, he asked himself, what did I like to do when I was a kid? How did I spend, like, if nobody was telling me what to do, if I had free time, how would I spend it as a kid? And he kind of backwards engineered that to figure out what he needed to be doing now. And so I think because of that, a lot of us, we have things we've always loved. Maybe it's drawing, or maybe it's cooking, or, you know, whatever it is. And so we peck around that, but we don't give it the energy that it would require if we really stopped and said, this is it. This is my highest enthusiasm, and I need to live into it because it's going to feed me and it's going to feed the world.
Beautiful, beautiful stuff. And so next is like this. I'm thinking it's like, all right, now that I've, you know, found this, and now that I am, what happens is like there a transformation to the person? Is that what you're actually watching? You're watching whole people be transformed over, you know, your 6 weeks or 8 weeks or, you know, process of coaching them? Like, you're watching just amazing transformations happen before your eyes?
I like to think so. the photographer that I was talking about a little bit ago, we, at our last meeting, he kind of said something to me. We were talking about, like, we kind of had found this direction of, okay, here's the direction you need to go in. And he kind of said to me, he's like, well, I could do this, but that'll never work. And basically, when you're saying that'll never work, what you're saying is, I'm not the kind of person that can do that. And so I think that's garbage. And I told him as much. Like, you decide what your identity is. You decide, I'm not the kind of person who can quit smoking. I'm not the kind of person who can have abs. You know, that's for other people. Other people are really in shape. Other people are really successful. Other people are millionaires. That'll never be me. Well, as long as you're telling yourself that, that's going to be the case. And so when you find what your bliss is, you have an opportunity to say, this is who I'm going to be, and this is the thing I'm going to devote my time and energy to. And when you do that, I think the potential for transformation is off the charts.
Are people generally becoming more like emotionally and mentally stable? I mean, I'm just listening to you going, wow, I feel more emotionally happy. You know, I mean, just by, you know, listening to you talk about this, because I think it's something that every person, just on the basic, you know, it's almost like you're getting in touch with your humanity on so many different levels. I mean, and I think we're afraid as people. I saw an incredible quote, you know, the other day. I was reading a book, a Christian book, and they were talking about people are afraid to call Jesus human, whereas back when you know, Jesus was alive, they were afraid to call him God. And and this is like that low Christology type of, you know, and I know we're not talking Christianity, but there's this like human aspect. It's okay to get in touch with your humanity. You know, you need to know who you are, and God is probably calling you to get in touch with that human side of your person, right? I mean, there's something that it gave you a lot of peace in your own personal life, right? It gave you peace. It, you kind of was like, oh, I finally got it now, right?
Absolutely. I will tell you, I have never been happier in my life. Now, there are people I know in the world I used to work in that would say, well, happiness isn't the point of life. First of all, I think I disagree with that, but we don't have to get into that. But yes, I am not a humanist in the sense of I believe in transcendence. I believe in there is something. I'm not prepared to say what it is, but I am not a humanist in the sense of we are all there is. But I'm a humanist in the sense of, holy crap, it is so incredible to be a human. And whoever made this and whoever created this way put so much inside of us. And to me, the point of religion, the point of bliss, the point of all of this is going inside of yourself and getting past this crappy persona that we put up that says, oh, well, I work in an office and I'm a plumber and I drive this car and I make this much money and that's who I am. Like, that's the us that we present to the world, but that is not the real us. And when you get a glimpse of who the real you is, there's a reason I talk about it in the podcast a lot. I call it finding your highest enthusiasm. And it is impossible to talk calmly about your highest enthusiasm. And so helping people connect with this right now, I think, is my highest enthusiasm. And so I love to see people unafraid to be human. And like you said, there is a lot of there's been a lot of angst on either side about talking about what Jesus is. And even as a non-practicing Christian, I have a lot of thoughts about Jesus. And I think he was the perfect model for us and our humanity. And the idea of killing the bad parts of you that aren't helping you, being willing to let those die and being reborn as a new version of yourself that can literally change the world. I'm sorry, I've gone to preaching on your podcast here.
No, how apologize. Beautiful. How beautiful is that, though? I mean, this is what, you know, this is what we are about. This is what we're about here at, you know, Patchwork Heart Ministry, because what we're trying to do is help people find hope. I mean, that's my tagline, is sowing hope into broken hearts. And so, awesome. And so, you know, finding that hope, finding that reason to live, and how beautiful that is. And if we can't have conversations with people who have a different perspective, we've gone far, 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 way off the rails. So, you know, Patch, I hate to say it, but we're out of time, and I would love to like talk with you for another 4 hours, but you'd probably charge me. So, no. This is awesome, and I thank you for being my guest today. Give our listeners a brief snapshot of, you know, where they can find your stuff and whatnot. I know you're on Breadbox, but whatever else you want to promote there.
Yeah, so my podcast is on Breadbox Media. You can. I'm also on Facebook under Patch Drury, but also under Blissed, the podcast. You can email me at patchdrury@gmail.com, or you can go to my website, patchdrury.net, and contact me there. There's information about what I do and how I do it, and I would love to talk to anybody. Like I said, I'm based in Kentucky, but there are a million technological ways that we can talk and form a relationship and start this journey together if somebody's interested. But I'm on the Instagrams and all of that stuff. You can Patch Drury, PATCHDRURY. You can type that in and I'll pop up a lot of places.
Awesome. Well, Patch, thank you so much again for being with me here on Young Catholics Respond.
This was absolutely a pleasure. Thank you, Bill.
All right. Well, this has been an episode of Young Catholics Respond. Until next time, from all of us at Patchwork Heart Ministry, keep beating to your Catholic heart.
This has been an episode of Young Catholics Respond. For more information about our program, or to be a guest, visit patchworkheart.org, email info@patchworkheart.org, or call 424-704-3278. That's 424-704-3278.